So now the Prophet ﷺ is passing by Abu Talib, and as years pass by again, Abu Talib, the time comes, he passes away without iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals the verse, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. The Prophet ﷺ, he cries and cries and cries, that the uncle who took care of me, and the reality was Abu Talib, he treated the Prophet ﷺ just as his own child. The treatment the Prophet ﷺ received from Abu Talib, again, he built such a bond with the Prophet ﷺ in a very short period of time, that Abu Talib again became like a father to the Prophet ﷺ. And we see this from the incident of when the Prophet ﷺ was 12 years old. Abu Talib was traveling for a business trip to Sham. And when he was leaving, he said to the Prophet ﷺ, he was departing everyone. And then finally Abu Talib, before he set off for the trip, he came to the Prophet ﷺ and said to the Prophet ﷺ that I am leaving for a short trip. I will come back after some time, I'm going for some business. And then when the Prophet ﷺ heard that his uncle was departing him, tears came to the eyes of the Prophet ﷺ. That once again a beloved was leaving. Once again a beloved was leaving. So Abu Talib, when he saw these tears in the eyes of the Prophet ﷺ, he said to the Prophet ﷺ that I can't see you crying, come along with me. And that was the only child that he took along with him to the trip. The very famous story, they met Buhayra Rahib on the way, and then the Prophet ﷺ was sent back to Makkah Mukarramah because there were death threats. Abu Talib then assigned Bilal radiallahu anhu to take the Prophet ﷺ back to Makkah Mukarramah. Very long and lengthy incident. But the point I'd like to mention is that the Prophet ﷺ was tested there again. And then what happens is the Prophet ﷺ grows up, his uncle Abu Talib passes away. The very same year, his wife, Hazrat Khadija, passes away. The very same year, the Prophet ﷺ is stoned by the people of Makkah Mukarramah. A few years pass by, the Prophet ﷺ is asked to leave his homeland and migrate to Madinah Munawwarah. And who are the people that are forcing him out of his community? Not his enemies, his own family. His own family are the people that are planning to come and kill him. And the Prophet ﷺ then arrives in Medina Munawwara, and all the difficulties that take place there, all the battles that take place, and the scene of the Prophet ﷺ arriving in Medina into the battle of Badr, and the Prophet ﷺ is crying away, oh Allah, that if you don't help the deen today, oh Allah, if you don't support the deen today, oh Allah, if you don't grant us your assistance, what will happen to this deen, oh Allah? These are the only people that support your religion. And the Prophet ﷺ is crying away. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu says to the Prophet ﷺ, stop now. This is enough. There's no way your du'as won't be accepted. And then what happens? هَذَا يُمْدِدُكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ بِخَمْسَةِ آلَافٍ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ. هَذَا يُمْدِدُكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ. Now your Lord is helping you. What happens? 5,000 angels come into the battlefield, and these angels in the field, they blow these people away. The angels, they descend into the field, and they blow these people away. The narrations say, the angels came with yellow imamas on that day. Again, a support for the imam, through the narration of the Prophet ﷺ. They came with the imamah, with yellow imamas that day, and they blew their heads off. They blew all them guys off, all of them off one by one. They blew them all away. So the Prophet ﷺ was tested time after time. And the tests of the Prophet ﷺ, if we look at them, subhanAllah, they're never ending. It was like every day there was a new test. As Aisha radiallahu anha says, we discuss this in detail, that for 2 months the stove didn't turn on in our house. For 2 months there was nothing that was cooked in our house. They lived off aswadain, water and dates. Two things. They lived off two things for 2 months. And who was this? It wasn't a person like me. This was Sayyid al-Alameen, Sayyid Rasulullah Rabbil Alameen, the leader of all prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The leader of everything, the best of all creation, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the difficulties and the test the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam faced every day was something new. The wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Aisha. She is being accused, and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the companions, they see, and he has two stones tied to his stomach. All these things, when we look at them, subhanallah, we see that these were the sacrifices the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam decides to do Umrah. He sees a dream. He tells the companions, "Let's go perform Umrah." They set off, and they were coming to Makkah Mukarramah. The people of Makkah don't grant them entry. The very famous incident, the famous Sulah of Hudaybiyah. The Prophet ﷺ, he's not granted entry. And then finally they come to a conclusion that they're going to write a treaty. And then when they're writing this treaty, Hazali radiallahu anhu, he is the one who's writing it. And he writes that this treaty is between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the people of Makkah. So the people that were standing there, they said to Hazali radiallahu anhu, that if you're writing on the treaty, Muhammad the Messenger of Allah, and we believe in this, then there would be no difference. Why would we stop him then? If we knew he was the Messenger of Allah, we wouldn't dare stop him. We would let him in. We do not believe he's the Messenger of Allah. Rub this out. Rub off Rasulullah. So the Hazali radiallahu anhu says, that's not happening. So then they tell the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that if you want this treaty to happen, you have to move away from there, the Messenger of Allah. The Prophet ﷺ, he turns to Hazali radiallahu anhu and says to Hazali radiallahu anhu, remove Rasulullah next to my name. Hazali radiallahu anhu says, this is my iman. How can I move? This is my belief. So then the Prophet ﷺ, he takes the pen from Hazali radiallahu anhu's hand and he rubs it on himself. And he writes, Muhammad the son of Abdullah. So this was the sacrifice the Prophet ﷺ did. This is something very big. This is something very big in itself. These were the sacrifices the Prophet ﷺ made. And the sacrifices of the Prophet ﷺ were above everything. So if the Prophet ﷺ was required to make these sacrifices, another incident. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu says that he came to the Prophet ﷺ, a very famous incident, the incident of Ilah, where the Prophet ﷺ, he did not go close to his wives for a period of time. And he had a room in which the Prophet ﷺ stayed in, and he did not go close to any of his wives because of the situation that took place. There was a story, a whole incident behind it. However, the Prophet ﷺ was in this room above, and no one had spoken to the Prophet ﷺ for days. The Prophet ﷺ was very upset. He was upset, and none of the wives were speaking to the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ wasn't speaking to anyone. So finally, when Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu found out that the Prophet ﷺ wasn't speaking to his wives, he went to his daughter. And his daughter was also the wife of the Prophet ﷺ. What was the name of the daughter of Umar radiallahu anhu? Hafsa bint Umar radiallahu anhu. So when when Hazrat Umar found out that the Prophet ﷺ was upset with his with the wives, and in the wives was also his daughter, he went and he told her off first. What have you people done? Just because you're the wives, you think you can? So he basically lectured her. After lecturing her, he came to the place where the Prophet ﷺ was. He knocked. Who is it? Umar. So the Prophet ﷺ granted permission. This is the first person that spoke to the Prophet ﷺ. So then Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, when he comes in the room where the Prophet ﷺ is sitting, and the Prophet ﷺ, he sits up, and Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu comes inside. And Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, when he sees the Prophet ﷺ is stressed, and he's in this worry. So the first thing Umar radiallahu anhu says to the Prophet ﷺ, O Prophet of Allah, why did we even move to Medina? In Makkah, our women used to listen to us, now they come in, now they rule over us. So when the Prophet ﷺ heard this, he began to laugh. The Prophet ﷺ began to smile. And the Prophet ﷺ had a smile for days. So the Prophet ﷺ, he began to smile and said, Umar, you're speaking the truth. So then Umar radiallahu anhu, he looked at the shoulder of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the mat the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was lying on, it left marks in the blessed body of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Umar radiallahu anhu, when he saw this, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "What is this? The kings of the Roman and Persian Empire are enjoying their life sleeping on silk, and here you are, the king of all mankind, and you have marks on your shoulder." What does the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? "Ama tarda ya Umar an yakuna lahum ad-dunya wa illa al-akhirah." Oh Umar, doesn't it please you that they enjoy the world, we enjoy the hereafter? So if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is tested, if Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, the grandfather of the Prophet in his Abba, Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, if he is tested, and what is the test of Ibrahim alayhi salam? That they take a catapult and they shoot him inside the fire. The fire is so hot that he can't even be thrown inside the head. What do they have to use? They have to use a tool to take Ibrahim alayhi salam and launch him into the fire. This is the test that he's put through. And the entire country is watching. Everyone is watching. Ibrahim alayhi salam goes inside, he comes back out alive. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam is told that take your wife, Hajar, and take your son Ismail and drop them off in the middle of the desert in Makkah Mukarram. The sacrifice there. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he drops them off there, as a Hajar says to her husband, Ibrahim alayhi salam, then why are you leaving us here? There's no water here, there's no one here, nothing here. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he walks away. He's not answering her, because he's been told that after you leave them there, don't talk to them. So then as a Hajar, she begins to say, what are you doing? Why are you leaving us here? Our child's going to die, what's going to happen to me? So then she sees that her husband isn't replying. She says that this must be the order of Allah. Ibrahim alayhi salam points to the sky and says, yes, this is the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Hajar says that if it is the order of Allah, Allah will take care of us. Again, the sacrifice made there. And then the sacrifice after sacrifice, Ibrahim alayhi salam is told to slaughter his son. That again is a sacrifice. Then we look at Yusuf alayhi salam, another prophet of Allah. The sacrifice he had to give. A young child, small baby, Yusuf alayhi salam, young child. His brothers take him, they drop him into a well. Put yourself in the position and imagine the emotion of Yusuf alayhi salam. He's taken, he's dropped into the well. And then he's brought up, he is the son of a prophet of Allah. The travelers, they take him out of the well, they take him to Egypt and they sell him as a slave. A person that's free, imagine a person, someone takes your freedom from you in a blink of an eye. You're a free person. And above this, you're a son of the Prophet of Allah. And here what happens is, your freedom is taken away from you and you're made into a slave. This is what happened to Yusuf alayhi salam. And then Yusuf alayhi salam is then, a step ahead of this, he's thrown into the jail. So the sacrifice of Yusuf alayhi salam made for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.